The now 16-year-old girl is currently in close custody at the Alberta Hospital in Edmonton. In order to begin her reintegration, her treatment team and her lawyers say she needs more exposure to the outside world.
We have to appreciate, of course, that she's been in custody for 4 years, and it's a big 4 years, given that she's now 16. And so, certainly there have been a number of changes, and as the treatment team indicated, she's not in a normal situation, and so she's a very different person now than she was then.
Crown Prosecutor Ramona Robbins did express some issues with the report that was given to the court by the treatment team, specifically a part that mentioned the girl was having issues understanding the severity of the murders.
We all know she'll be out in the community one day, that's inevitable, and what kind of person is she going to be, what kind of adult is she going to be? So those are the types of questions I have daily, and especially when there's an annual review.
If her treatment team decides to plan any trips off of the Alberta Hospital facility, they will need to submit those plans in detail to the Solicitor General, who will then approve the plans, deny the plans, or make amendments to them to assure that there is no risk to the community.
I have every confidence in the Solicitor General's department. I work with them every day, and so I have every confidence that whatever risk is presented to the public will be very carefully managed, and no changes will occur without them making sure that the whole community is safe.
I think it's going to be beneficial to her in treatment in terms of a gradual reintegration. Instead of doing it in big jumps, it can be a much smoother transition this way.
The girl's team says they are continuing to assess her and stress that any reintegration will be done in baby steps, starting with walks around the facility, going into other buildings in the facility, before going out into the Edmonton community. The girl herself did appear in court today via closed-circuit television, and when asked if she had anything to add, only said to the judge, "Thank you for the opportunity." Her next court appearance will be in 6 months. Riley Carlson, Chat News.
And what kind of person is she going to be? What kind of adult is she going to be? So those are the types of questions I have.
Hello, beautiful people, and welcome to Crimes That Suck, the true crime channel that brings you crime all the time. That's the hope, at least. Now, if you're new to the channel, thank you for coming. Welcome. I hope you stay with us on this journey and watch it till the end. Today's case is going to be about a 12-year-old named Jasmine Richardson who managed to bring murder to a small town in Canada called Medicine Hat. Now, for all my subscribers, welcome back and thank you for showing support. Now, of course, at the end of the video, I would love to get your input, so don't forget to leave a comment in the comment box below. Or if you just want to say hi, I'll take that as well. This is your host, Beats. Now, let's get into the case of a 12-year-old named Jasmine Richardson who brought murder to a small town in Canada. When we think about vampires, you usually think of the typical fangs, can't come out into the sun, turns into a bat, or flies at night, blood-sucking creatures. Well, the blood part is probably true in this story as well. Let me tell you about Jasmine and Jeremy, the natural-born killer wannabes with a twist of vampire in it. Jasmine and Jeremy would go on to change Medicine Hat forever. Three members of the Richardson family are brutally murdered in the small town in Canada. The only survivor is their 12-year-old daughter, Jasmine. The people of Medicine Hat were shocked when the identity of the killer emerged. Jasmine, together with her boyfriend, killed her mother, father, and brother. She was the youngest person in Canadian history to be convicted of multiple homicides. Jasmine Richardson met Jeremy Stein at a punk concert. According to Jasmine's friends and family, she was a happy, social, go-lucky girl before, but Jeremy quickly changed her. The 11-year difference in their ages disturbed a lot of people, but it was the change in lifestyle and attitude which most found very shocking. Formerly a typical small-town Canadian teen, Jasmine fell in love with Jeremy and his lifestyle. Jeremy introduced her to his warped take on the goth subculture. Instantly, Jasmine found her niche, and she became a regular poster on websites such as vampirefreaks.com. She started wearing heavy makeup and all black outfits. In one fell swoop, Jasmine turned from typical preteen into a menacing version of her former self. You know, everyone went around saying that Jeremy was a bad influence to Jasmine, that he changed her. And I'm not saying that he wasn't a bad influence towards her. They obviously were toxic together. Otherwise, I wouldn't be sitting here talking about the murders they committed. Now, we can't forget the fact that Jasmine did, all on her own, go on these websites. The gothic websites, the vampire freaks. No one helped her do that. So she herself was definitely looking for a change. Everyone knew that the Richardson family was the model family, but Jeremy didn't have that luxury. He grew up in a toxic family. And I'm not saying this to justify or give him an excuse, but the Steinke family, Jeremy's family, was very toxic. His mother was an alcoholic, and her boyfriend used to abuse him on a daily basis. And school wasn't even an escape for him either. The other children bullied Jeremy relentlessly. And by the time he met Jasmine, he had already tried to commit suicide. His difficult childhood meant that Jeremy had constructed a strange, elaborate persona. Everywhere he went, he wore a vial of human blood strung around his neck. And occasionally, he would claim to be a 300-year-old werewolf. Jeremy and Jasmine would listen to music, watch films, and do everything together. When Jasmine's family found out about their relationship, they tried to prevent her from seeing Jeremy. They didn't succeed. The relationship became more intense. Jasmine was convinced that she and Jeremy were falling deeply in love, despite the age difference between the two. Her parents' anger only helped to kindle the burning fires of their relationship, turning Jasmine against her family and further into Jeremy's arms. Jeremy too noticed the Richardson family's resentments towards him. He kept an online blog, and on the 3rd of April 2006, he complained extensively about the unfair treatment Jasmine received from her parents. He would close with pretentious lines like, "Their throats I want to slit. Finally, there shall be silence. Their blood shall be payment." Jasmine was growing further away from her family. The Richardsons had lost their innocent daughter, and they didn't know how to get her back. Everything they tried seemed to make her love for Jeremy even stronger. Jasmine began emailing Jeremy with fragments of a plan. "It begins with me killing them," she wrote, "and it ends with me living with you." "I love your plan," he replied, "but we need to get a little more creative with like details and stuff." From there, the idea grew. Jasmine's friends remember how she told them about the plan. They didn't believe that this young girl, their friend, could be seriously thinking about killing her parents. On the 22nd of April, 2006, Jasmine and Jeremy sat down together and watched the film. They selected Oliver Stone's 1994 film, Natural Born Killers, written by Quentin Tarantino. In this film, a young couple go on a love-inspired killing spree. The next day, Jasmine and Jeremy would change Medicine Hat forever. Tyler Richardson was just 8 years old. On the 23rd of April, his friend called at the Richardson household. But when the friend knocked on the door, there was no answer. The little boy peered in through a basement window, trying to spot Tyler. As he squinted through the glass, he could see no one. And then he saw a terrible sight. Staggering back from the house, Tyler's friend ran straight home to his mother. His mother called the police. The police arrived at the Richardson house. The inspector, Brent Sikandiak, didn't know what to expect. Following the information he had been given, he knocked at the house. When there was no answer, he went to the basement window and peered in. He could make out just about one person laying on the ground. He could tell something was wrong. The officer called for backup, hoping he'd still be able to save a life. The police knocked down the door. The officer went straight to the basement and found Mark and Deborah dead on the floor. The police wasted no time and searched the house top to bottom. Upstairs, they found young Tyler dead in his bedroom. Three dead people, all murdered. But there was no sign of the other Richardson child, 12-year-old Jasmine. Sikandiak put out a search for Jasmine. No one even considered that she might have been involved in the murders. But they had to find the girl and give her the terrible news about her family. While people searched for Jasmine, the police began to put together the events of the night before. The scene was terrible, one of the worst Sikandiak had ever witnessed. Deborah, it was decided, had been killed first. There were at least a dozen stab wounds all over her body. Mark seemed to have fought back, armed with a screwdriver. He had defensive wounds, slashes, and cuts, where he tried to defend himself, but to no avail. Both parents were both found dead in a pool of their own blood. But it was the murder of the 8-year-old which was the most shocking. Tyler had been asleep in his bed. Whoever had killed him approached him slowly, not disturbing the sleeping boy. With a knife, they slashed his throat wide open. The kid's bedroom was soaked in blood. Jasmine was still missing. The police released a statement saying they were searching for Jasmine Richardson with regards to a serious family matter. But as they searched the house, her locker, and interviewed her friends, Jasmine soon began to emerge as a suspect. They followed a trail of digital evidence, including emails between Jasmine and Jeremy. As well as a search for Jasmine, they put out a search for Jeremy's truck. The next day, the couple were picked up in Leader, Saskatchewan. By that time, they had become the primary suspects in the murder case. Jasmine and Jeremy both were charged with 3 murders. As well as the emails engaging between the lovers, the police interviewed a number of witnesses who said Jeremy confessed to the murders. He said that he gutted his victims like a fish. The story took hold of the Canadian press and shocked the nation. While Jeremy's story seemed both violent and tragic, it was Jasmine who really stunned the nation. At the time of her trial, her name could not legally be published by the press. She was only known as JR and could not be sentenced as an adult for at least another 2 years. This meant that, despite the nature of her crimes, the longest sentence Jasmine could receive was 10 years. The trial did not last long, and when Jasmine was found guilty of the 3 murders, she became the youngest person to be convicted of multiple murders in Canadian history. Jeremy was less morbidly fascinated. While in custody, he had talked to an undercover and admitted to the murders. Just like Jasmine, he was found guilty of all 3 murders. He received 3 life sentences to be served concurrently and will only be eligible for parole after 25 years of his sentence. The two exchanged letters frequently, and at no time did they express any remorse for their actions. In 2016, Jasmine was released from the criminal justice system. As shocking as the case was in Canada, the murder of the Richardson family left many unsatisfied. Jeremy and Jasmine never revealed their true motives, leaving people to speculate about why they killed. Perhaps they resented the Richardsons' disapproval of the relationship. Perhaps they were simply insane. But no explanation makes sense of the murder of Tyler, and the couple have never expressed any remorse. For all the talk of werewolves and vials of blood, for all the promising of running away together, Jeremy and Jasmine both served serious time. Perhaps one day, they will finally be together again. Now, for all of you who made it to the end, thank you very much for joining me on this case of 12-year-old Jasmine Richardson, the youngest Canadian to kill her whole family. She's probably about 16 now, and she's probably a free woman. Yep, that's right, they let her go. I would love to know what you think about this, so don't forget to leave in the comment box below if you think she should have went free, or if you think she should stay in jail for the rest of her life. This is your host, Beads, and I hope to see you on the next one. And depending on where you are by the time you watch this video, have a Merry Christmas, and I hope you have a great New Year. See you again next time.